All right, nerds. This is gonna be a video for all the total dorks like me, the people who are like obsessed with old freestyle shapes and the stuff that came before all the stuff that we have now. All the things that I make, that the guys at Never Enough make, that we make for freestyle, came from this huge like lineage of freestylers pushing to make really cool stuff. You need some background though. Let's explain where we are. So right now I'm at a skate shop called Never Enough. It's a skateboard shop owned by Christian Heise. It's run out of Brandenburg, Germany, just outside of Berlin. And it's about 2 days before I go to Paderborn for the freestyle championship, sort of. But while we're here, I'm totally digging through all of Christian's old freestyle board collection, because he is a freestyle skateboarder to the core. He's run this company and teams in the past. He has so much history with the sport and does so much now to give back. He even sells Waltz skateboards and a special line of Waltz skateboards in Germany. So if you live out here and you want Waltz boards, stuff that I make, you can get it here. But I don't want to talk about Waltz today. This isn't about Waltz. This is about all the stuff that came before Waltz, like I said, and I wanted to show you some of my favorites from his collection, because I totally was nerding out and like fully screaming in the back storage room when I was picking through all the old boards. One that I want to start off with, which is like probably one of the earliest boards that he has, is this Tracker flip side board. Tracker was a truck company, if a lot of you remember. My knowledge is not great about these boards. From what I understand, Tracker made this board for a guy named Per Holknecht. Super good style. He was like one of the early Swede freestylers who came to Huntington Beach, to California, and was crushing it in the freestyle scene. This board was made for him, and originally, when Tracker made it for him, they were airbrushing on a graphic. So it was kind of like those old mall t-shirts you'd see, like the crazy like memorial shirts people get in the mall. It was this record, so simple, it's like a two-color print, but like the art on this thing just stood out so much, and it's been copied, done over, and reissued so much. And what's really cool about this too, all the boards back then had kind of square rails, especially the freestyle boards, where this one had a square rail all through the top of the nose, and then for the middle of the board, it had this kind of bevel so that you could hook your foot under for like rail flips and stuff. Not rail flips, kick flips, old school kick flips. You could hook your foot underneath the board to flip it over for like freestyle kick flips, which I think is really cool. I'd love to see that on a board. Tracker flip side. Got a lot more boards to talk about, but that's probably one of the oldest ones in his collection, and honestly, one of the best condition boards he has. Blows my mind. Moving on. So we're talking about art and like cool art on skateboards. One that I feel like we should talk about is the Pierre-André Sims Screaming Frenchman. I don't know if that was actually what they called it. Similar to what I was just talking about with those rails, this has those little cut-ins too. You might be able to see here, it kind of starts to angle in. If you guys know Pierre-André, he actually ended up going and starting Etnies. Also, just Pierre had such a crazy style and was so fast. Like, for an old school OG freestyler, he was so sick. Pretty sure he invented the coconut wheelie too, so thanks Pierre. Unlike the flip side, a bit more like extreme with the graphic, more colors. It's like, what, 1, 2, 3, 4 or 5 colors plus the red stain. And it had this crazy like lettering that ran from top to bottom. Easy to cover up. I like being able to cover up my name when I'm riding boards with my name on them. But yeah, I mean, more extreme and more kind of detailed than the last board, a little bit more colors, but still a pretty simple graphic. Like a lot of kind of block shapes and a lot of really bold lines, not a lot of like feathering or like semitones. From like a print side of things, like a graphic side of things, not as extreme as some of the other ones we're gonna see. The graphics kind of got crazier and crazier, and one of my favorites from the 80s was this Tim Morris Walker graphic. So Walker was a company from Florida, and this freestyle rocket ship had, in my opinion, one of the best kind of semitone photorealistic prints on it. And these were all hand screened. So like people were taking decks, actually screening them nose to tail back in the day. Whereas nowadays, most graphics, if not like all graphics, are put on with a heat transfer. So it's a lot easier to get detail. But you have this stippling in there, this kind of semitone that transitions from pink to black. Super rad. This one's been reissued a bunch, but it's never been as cool, in my opinion, as the original. Tim Morris, I met this guy. He's actually really cool too. I think my Tim Morris Decomposed board was actually my first single kick. Moving on, one of my favorite freestylers ever from the kind of 80s, early 90s era of freestyle, sort of this weird dark age of freestyle, Fabian Kravitz. Now, there's not a whole lot of footage from this guy. There's one video of him skating Huntington Beach back in the day. There's another one of him skating in practice runs at a contest in like Anaheim. He skated like a modern freestyler, like wanted to go fast, flip his board a lot, and he could spin like a monster. But Circle A made this board for him right before kind of the crash of freestyle, the kind of dead end of freestyle in the, I think, late 80s, early 90s. This had a much more like comic booky illustrative kind of feel to it, a lot more like hatching and stippling. I love when boards can do this, when they can have just like a really simple stain, a really classic, gorgeous wood look to it, and then they can put a really intricate, good design between the trucks where you're gonna want to see it and where you're gonna see it when you have the board set up. There's no need to put a bunch of stuff on the tail, a bunch of stuff on the nose. You're gonna have grip tape or like a skid plate on there anyway, and you're gonna have trucks there covering up the graphic anyway. Keep the graphic where it matters, in the middle. Guys, after the like late 80s, early 90s, freestyle saw a huge decline in participation. We didn't have sponsors helping people out. It kind of died in a big way. But around that same time, we had Gunter Machulis, who's the like OG, like Darth Vader of freestyle, coming around and like destroying contests. He was killing it. And he had a board with Titus, a German skateboard company. And I think they were having boards produced by Santa Cruz. That's what Christian was just telling me. Christian's doing work right now in the other room, running a skate shop, doing online orders, killing it as always. But he was telling me that Santa Cruz actually produced this board. Now this is important because this is an 8-inch freestyle shape. 8 inches is huge. Like in comparison, that Fabian Kravitz board we just looked at was like 7.5 inches wide. And this is a weird looking board. Like by freestyle standards of the 80s, this is a crazy looking board. I was obsessed with this for the longest time. And it's, I mean, as a big board freestyler, as a guy who likes bigger shapes, being able to hold this in my hands, I was like tripping out super hard. And on top of that, it's got this awesome like kick nose rocker thing going on. I don't know what mold they were using to get this shape, but it's awesome. Yeah, I mean, it's just super simple, black, big color blocks, green, yellow, red, Rasta colors, and then this like Rasta graphic. I don't know what this is from, like a record cover or something, but I'll try to find it for all the real historians out there. You're like hating me right now. You're like, why don't you know this? Yeah, Titus, super sick. They're still around. They still distribute in Germany, I believe, and they made a huge board. I guess they actually messed up production, and this was supposed to be a smaller board. It's supposed to be not 8, but probably like 7.6 or something like that. And they made it, and Gunter, I guess, liked it anyway, so they just ran with it. Man, maybe one day we'll make a 8-inch single kick, but we're gonna have to have some really cool molding with it. That's really it. I just wanted to show off some of these boards that I found here, make a quick little video showing you some of the history of them. There's a whole lot online you can find about these boards. If you go to the Freestyle Trickopedia, I'll have a link to that. All right, I misspoke right there. What I meant to say was the Freestyle Knowledge Base, not the Freestyle Trickopedia. That's Reese Archibald's Instagram account. Back to the video. You'll be able to find a bunch of info about these and kind of a whole encyclopedia on freestyle boards from the 70s, the 80s, 90s, today, all across the board. We've come a really long way. As the skating develops, we as a community, as skateboarders as a whole, have been able to create products and create better tools to do tricks we want to do. We can kind of direct what we do and how we skate by making products to benefit that and to ease that process. I hope you like this video. I'll be making more while I'm out here. Stay tuned for more footage from Paderborn and from all the events that are going on this week. And until next time, keep dancing. I'm gonna go, I don't know, drink some tea and try to relax because I'm tweaking from these boards. They're so sick. Maybe if Christian's not looking, I'll set up the Gunter and skate it in the contest. I think he'll notice it. I was not on sale hotel, we didn't have no where to stay. At 29, I'm just